man. I can't say I'm like a lot of people in the church, a lot of musicians or a lot of people that was in church. I actually was in church still, playing on the music, playing the keyboard, steady coming to church singing, but I was living a totally different lifestyle. One of my biggest struggles was fast money, man. I've always had fast money. I started selling drugs, man, when I was 10 years old. You know, my mom was on crack cocaine, you know, for 17 years. My father was in the penitentiary 21 years. And I didn't start selling drugs, man, because that was something I just wanted to do and try to look cool to people. I started selling drugs because I felt like, because I know it's not politically correct to say I had to, but it's because I felt like I had to sell drugs. You know, I had a baby brother that, you know, you could see his rib cage and stuff like that. So I felt like I was obligated to be the provider, since, you know, I was the male in the house who pretty much had the sense. You know, my older brother, no shot at you, bro, because I know you watching this, probably gonna be angry. No shot at you, boss. It's just, I was the one in the house who pretty much had the sense. And my mother tell you now, it's like, I was the sensible one. So I knew something had to be done. You know, my mother was what we called a functioning crackhead, man. She would go to work Monday through Friday. And then on Fridays, we wouldn't see her again to possibly Monday, because she was gone again, getting high. And so I started selling drugs. That was one of my biggest struggles. But then, like Samson, like every other man, like Samson, man, one of my other biggest downfalls was, you know, them women. You know, that's just point blank, pain and period. It was just them women, man. So I struggled with fast money, women, and smoking weed. You know, I sold so much weed that it was like, you know, the addiction to it. You know, I was around it, I consumed it. And so I'm just real. I like keeping my book open so people understand it's nothing to hide from me. This is really a testimony for me, man. I sold drugs to the magnitude of, on a federal level, of selling drugs. And so because I had so much drugs, even when I stopped selling drugs and I told God, listen, God, I ain't gonna sell drugs no more, I still had the addiction to smoking weed. Because I sold it so much, because I had so much in mass amounts that I could put my hands on it at all times. So I was still addicted to it, man. I was still studying the Bible. I was having Bible studies with my boys, a lot of my cats. I'm 100. I was still having Bible study. We had never, everybody roll up and roll up. Let me roll up. Studying the word. I said, Lord, when I come out of here, I'm either going to be a preacher, I'm still going to be the kingpin. So I even got a sermon, man, called From the Kingpin to the Pulpit. And I said, Lord, either I'm going to be a kingpin still, or I'm gonna be preaching. And man, that's what happened, man. God eventually took that addiction from me, man, took that taste from me. And I mean, now, you know, I'm clean. And so, like I said, I promise God, these are the vows that I promise God. And I know a lot of y'all are gonna look at me crazy, but this is just me. I said, God, if I ever stick my vessel in any other woman than my beautiful wife, baby, I love you. I know you're watching this, Miss Shapeshaw. Baby, I love you. If I ever stick my vessel in any other woman other than my wife, then Lord, you can kill me dead. Now, that might sound harsh to you, but that's a reality for me. That's something that I have to live up to with God. And the Bible says, when you vow a vow, defer not to keep it, lest the angels in heaven charge you. So then I said, Lord, if I ever go back and sell drugs ever again, and Lord knows, it ain't like I didn't enjoy selling drugs. I enjoyed my money. I enjoyed buying chinchilla coats. I enjoyed that stuff. I really did. But I told God, if I ever go back and sell drugs ever again, God, you can lock me up under the federal penitentiary and throw the key away. Sounds harsh to you, but it's a reality to me. I told God again, God, if I ever go back and smoke weed again, God, you can kill me dead. Now, to some of y'all, that sounds stupid because you want to keep the door open. But to me, it's not stupid because I know I'm not going back to that field again. So I'm not going to play with God like that. I would be too afraid that I would be sitting there smoking weed and everybody else would think I'm just smoking some of the best weed in the world. They'd be like, ooh, I got to have it. I need some of it. But I'd be scared. I'd be over there choking to death for real. Based on what I told God. So that's how real I am. And I always said, man, if I ever do gospel music, I want to be real about it, because so many of them make gospel look so bad, because you hear about the stuff that they do behind the scenes. You hear about these illegitimate kids, and then you hear about this. I told God, I don't ever want to bring a reproach to the house of God. So I want to make sure I'm sincere with what I do. And that's what I'm doing. I'm not going to bring reproach to the house of God. I'm not going to bring reproach or shame to my house. I'm not going to bring reproach or shame to my name. So that's what I felt like I had to do.
It don't matter what others say, no. I really don't care what other people do. But as for me, I'm gonna give you praises. All because I'm
all my life to you.
So because of where God brought me from, when God saved you, he don't save you to change that person you are. He saved you to use that person for him. For example, when he came and got James and John from Zebedee's fishing company, he said, come follow me. I'm going to make you fisher of men. That means use your gift for me. So it didn't click till that Sunday morning when I got up in the church and I told everybody in the church, man, I just, God was tugging on me, man. It slowed all my business down, man. I had slabs on top of slabs, on top of slabs, on top of slabs in the trap house. But God had slowed everything down. Nobody was coming. Some of my best customers that I used to hit with the 1-2. For all of y'all that still smoking and doing what y'all, if you don't know what the 1-2 is, the 1-2 is, man, I only got 3 of them left, dog. You need to come get these. That's a lie. I know it because I originated that, dog. So I would call on, I'd be like, man, I only got 2 left. Man, all of them cash, man, used to come spend $10,000, $20,000. They come spend that type of money, and then next thing you know is nobody answering the telephone, nobody picking up the phone. So I got up in that church Sunday morning. I told the people, I said, man, y'all musician has been, you know, the biggest drug dealer in the town, man, or around here for the last 5 years, man. I mean, the church, man, they was looking, some was confused, some stood up and gave a standing ovation, which was a lot of them that knew I was, and they couldn't really believe that I was standing up in the church. I mean, it's still going through the town. Like, I can't believe you stood up in the church and told them folk you had drugs and everything. And what people fail to realize, the Bible talk about you confessing your faults one to another. And if the devil can't use those secrets in my life no more to accuse me and stand before God to try to accuse, then, you know, I feel better. I feel free. So I'm not, like I said, my life is transparent, man. I don't try to hide anything because I understand, man, that there's somebody else that was struggling just like I was. So I stood up, I told the church, man, I sold these drugs for the last 5 years, man. And ever since then, I'll be honest, ever since they put my grandfather in the ground, hey, man, I've been on fire. I've been preaching, teaching. Man, I mean, it was just that type of transformation. It wasn't something that I had to take 6 weeks to do. Now it did. Now I'm gonna be truthful, it did take me another 2 months to stop smoking weed. Now I'm being real with you, it took me another 2 months to stop smoking weed, but I'm smoke free now.